It affects your hormone levels. It affects your metabolism. It does all of these crazy things. We're only barely scraping the surface of understanding everything that it does.
Is there any research into whether you can take probiotics in some way and impact the bladder microbiome?
Again, that's tricky. So there is no evidence that an oral probiotic, that the same strains that you consume in an oral probiotic end up in the bladder.
Mm-hmm.
That is, we've tried to measure that. In fact, there's no evidence that if you consume a probiotic that those same strains end up in the vagina either.
Mm-hmm.
That's been looked at many different times, and it's really iffy. But that doesn't mean there aren't benefits. Mm-hmm. And this is where it gets complex, if it hasn't been complex already. is that taking a probiotic can change your gut microbiome. And we know that your gut microbiome has a whole range of effects for your entire body. There is the gut-brain axis. There is the, they're talking about the gut-kidney axis now.
Mm-hmm.
It affects your immune system. It affects things circulating in your bloodstream. And it affects your hormone levels. It affects your metabolism. It does all of these crazy things. We're only barely scraping the surface of understanding everything that it does. So the current kind of hypothesis that everyone's working under is that consumption of probiotics has a downstream effect that mm-hmm. promotes vaginal and bladder health.
Okay.
For example, maybe decreasing the load of E. coli in your gut. You mm-hmm. take a probiotic, there's lower amounts of E. coli, therefore less of it to then recolonize and infect the vagina and the bladder. Alternatively, it can be again, an ecosystem change. So it would be like planting a lot of trees in a place results in new birds and therefore new insects that other animals will come and eat. And all of a sudden you have an entirely different forest than you did mm-hmm. before. And that can have downstream effects where you're then promoting health of the vagina and you have more lactobacillus in the vagina. Therefore you have more lactobacillus in
right.
the bladder. Now, this is all hypothetical.
Yeah.
These are the assumptions we're currently working under, but mm-hmm. no one has an answer for it yet. We mm-hmm. only have little hints of ideas.
Yes, always the most frustrating thing to hear. And it's the most common thing that we hear as well. More research is needed. I feel yes. like a broken record most of the time.
Yeah. There's a lot of research coming out around kidney stones, primarily.
Mm-hmm.
And as humans, we don't actually metabolize oxalate. The most common form of kidney stones is calcium oxalate kidney stones. And you can apparently measure the amount of oxalate excreted in the urine is directly correlative to how many stones you get. So like mm-hmm. high stone formers have a lot of oxalate. Low stone formers have very low. There was a paper that came out recently that was looking at the gut microbiome and oxalate metabolism in the gut microbiome. And okay. sure enough, they found that low stone formers have a lot of the genetic potential to metabolize oxalate compared to high stone formers.
Right.
So the idea there would be to, again, take a probiotics supplement or somehow encourage the growth of these oxalate metabolizers so that there's less oxalate circulating and therefore mm-hmm. you don't make kidney stones. There's also some evidence in flies, which, oh, so close to humans. That the cells in their kidneys that filter out, that filter your blood, are also filtering out microbiota-derived components. So mm-hmm. bacteria have a coating called peptidoglycan, and when they die, they release it. And this is a potent immune inflammation trigger, basically. So when you have an infection, your immune system is going to go crazy once it sees peptidoglycan mm-hmm. where it's not supposed to be. Now, in these flies that couldn't filter out the peptidoglycan, you had a lot more of it circulating. And so the immune system was on high alert all the time. and was really good at fighting off infection, but they also had very low lifespans.
Yeah, right.
You just can't function with your immune system going that crazy all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there's everything from immune regulation to, again, what you metabolize and what's kind of circulating through your body. The gut microbiome is very important for all of those.
Mm-hmm. How does the microbiome impact the immune system, in particular the gut, vagina, and urinary tract?
So there is a very tight relationship between the microbiome in general and the immune system. And one of the key functions of the microbiota is to train the immune system, mm-hmm. Tell it what is foreign and what is normal. What do I need to attack and what do I need to tolerate? The gut microbiome is constantly training your immune system, constantly. And we know a lot of this from mouse models where we have mice that are completely microbiota free and their immune system is hair trigger. It'll go off like that. And that's not necessarily a good thing.
Yeah.
You don't want your immune system to go off every time you take a bite of food or that, you know, hasn't been sterilized, or every time you, you know, get a slight cut on your skin, you go septic, right? Like that's not good. So it's a really important thing to have this balance between the microbiota and your immune system. And it's why it's important for young kids to be exposed to lots of different foods and, you know, go ahead and eat dirt, but at the same time, get your vaccinations. Mm-hmm. Again, it's all to kind of promote a healthy response of your immune system. And now how that how that all works in the vagina or the bladder, I don't really know.
Yeah.
Yeah. The primary connection there is with the gut.
Okay. How do you create a mouse that is free of a microbiome?
They're called germ-free mice. Mm-hmm. They are born and raised entirely in a microbiota-free environment. Their food is autoclaved. Their bedding is autoclaved. They live in these cages that are completely sterilized before they're introduced. So they are, microbiota free as well as we can measure.
Right.
And they're very useful for studies because mm-hmm. we can then put in whatever microbiota we want and test what the response is going to be. Okay. If we want to put together a cocktail of 10 bacteria and colonize the gut with those and then infect a pathogen and see what happens. It gives us a very clean system in which we can look at these microbiota host interactions.